Welcome to part two of the mountain scene tutorial. So far, we have a great sky and mountains, so it's time to start putting in that landscape. I think the sky went really well, and we've seen that we can use tools and don't have to be intimidated by paintbrushes. If we are intimidated by them, you can use so many other things. So let's get started with part two. And these mountains for background. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to go with some of this green and just kind of tap in some. I'll show you in a second what I'm doing. I'm just going to tap in some little lines back here. Oops, Kristen, clean off your stick. I'm deliberately not using an artist paintbrush, though I love to use paintbrushes. I'm deliberately not doing that because I want to make sure that everybody feels comfortable using the things that they have at hand. Sometimes a paintbrush for someone who doesn't feel that they're artistic enough is intimidating. And so I want you to see, I don't like that at all. Let's get rid of some of that. That was too much. And then I'm going to take the end of this little chopstick. It's a chopstick. I broke the other half, so it was a really nice kind of chopstick. But you know what? Dropped it in paint one day, and now it's not. So I'm imagining that there is a line of pine trees hanging out back there. And I want them to be dark. So see how I'm just zigzagging and making it a little bit bigger as I go down? That's what I'm going to do with all of these. We don't care if they look like perfect, beautiful pine trees because they're background. They're just going to be in the background. Woohoo! So have a good time. I didn't take woohoo from anybody. I've been doing that since I was a teenager. And I am long past teenagerness. But so I did grow up in an era of 80s and 90s, maybe late 70s, I don't know, where everything was cool or you know, those kind of things. Woohoo! Not rad. Rad was the generation after me. That was annoying. Sorry for you rad people out there. You can be rad all you want. But I was young and adult and way too cool to use that word. Though awesome has worked its way into my vocabulary. So, do you see what we're doing here? Already, we're getting the image of some trees. I need to drip from the bottom up because the biggest drip's on the bottom. So my tops can be pointier. I decided not to go back to the stick. I'm just going to use my chopstick to add a few more things back here. Alright, one more, two or three, over here on the edge. You see what I'm doing? I'm just dipping a chopstick in paint, and now that I've learned, starting at the bottom and just pushing it up, dripping it up, and then I'll go back to the top and just make these little zigzaggies. See that? They don't even have to look like trees. They're just stuff. They fool the eye into thinking you're looking at the pine trees and cedar trees at the base of a mountain range. That's all. Do you see trees when you're looking at me paint this? Are you starting to see some of this forestation happening? Maybe you're a little taller back there. I'll just make you a little taller. Sorry. I also grew up in an age where I was a little girl when Bob Ross was on TV painting happy little trees and pretty little clouds and saying, oh, I think a bush lives here. So yeah, that happens to me too. I channel my inner Bob. My dad was Bob, is named Bob too, but I think he thought that Bob Ross was kind of a hippie kind of sort of Bob. And he was, which is why I identified with him, because I was a rebellious child. And so, you know, anything my dad thought was no fun, there I was, right in the thick of it. I don't like this white blob right there. There. That's a little better. All right. See there? With nothing, no brush, just spoons and a cheapy little, I got this cheapy little set of palette knives for like $5 on Amazon. There were four or five of them. Those, and the back of a spoon is almost my favorite unless I'm trying to make a point. And then my trusty handy dandy chopstick has got us this, all this. And so now what I want to do is start to put in just a few things that might be in the background that are swipes, kind of like the sky, like this backdrop. So I'm going to drizzle some green across here. Blot it off on my rag. Then I'm going to drizzle a little copper back in here. Maybe there's some, you know, fall's beginning, and those are evergreens back there, but some of this foliage in the mid-range background, maybe it's got some browns and oranges in it. Ooh, orange. Ooh. Nah, I won't do orange, but I might grab a little yellow. Not sure. Okay, maybe a little gold, too. Now, again, I'm not creating anything back here but texture. We want a little texture. Texture. So I'm just doing this, and then I'm going to get my spoon. I'm going to swipe. Woo-hoo. Wiping some background. I'm wondering if I put silicone in my gold after all, because it's not really coming out much for me. So let me put one more drop in there. Give her a stir. Oh, I see some good cell structures coming up. Now, when you're painting with things like dimethicone, many people will say, well, I don't want to paint with stuff, additives in my paint, because it's not archival. And I just want to say, just so you know, nothing that wasn't invented 500 years ago can be known to be archival, okay? So rubbing alcohol when you're told that that's archival, not necessarily so. Yes, it evaporates off the canvas, but that doesn't mean that some of it hasn't depleted paint structure. So unless you're wanting your paintings to be in a museum 1,000 years from now, don't worry about archival. As long as you let your painting cure at least 3 weeks and you somehow clean the silicone off. I know Christina Welch and some other people like to use like a cornstarch or talc blend to sit on their paintings and soak out for a while. I am of the idea that Dawn dishwashing liquid has always worked great for me. The blue stuff, the original blue Dawn dishwashing liquid. It's what they use to get oil off of animals who've been trapped in oil slicks. And if it works for them, it works for cleaning silicone off a surface. About a week after this dries, I'm going to clean it off with Dawn dishwashing liquid. Then I'm going to leave it another 2 weeks. And then I'm going to make sure there's no new silicone that's risen to the surface. And I'm going to clean it again before I varnish. So That's the way to make your paintings last for a very long time. You don't have to worry about if whatever you're using is archival. Otherwise, all those mixed media artists in the museums are going to be in big trouble because they're not being archival when they put all that stuff on their paintings. Okay? Okay. Lecture time. Did anybody notice that I'm a little teachery sometimes? It's because I'm a teacher. I've been a teacher for a while. I was really sick for a little over a year last year and couldn't work outside the home. And so, coming back to my art, I taught English, by the way, and before that, special education in high school. And I also worked in the mental health field for many, many years. So, I have a lot of that stuff on my plate. But now, this is what I do. So, if I get a little teachery, it's because I'm kind of a natural teacher. Hope it doesn't bug you. Okay, so now I have this really cool and interesting sort of background going on back there. I'm gonna do one thing that you might think is wild. No, I'm not. No, I'm not. Never mind. I don't wanna be too wild. Not with background. So now what I need to do. Oh, sorry, I didn't mean to bump the camera. Wiggle, wiggle, wiggle. I've stopped attaching the camera to my table, but I just walked by it. That's what happened. Sorry about that. But anyway, so this is what you want as a background. And now I'm trying to decide what kind of trees or landscape I want in my foreground. Do I want kind of a. I want kind of a hill that goes down this way. Scoop my spoon over that a little bit. And then another one kind of behind, up that way, so that there's just a little bit of a valley down there. I'm just too centered. I don't want that. I don't like things right in the center. It makes it look too formal, not real. So maybe I want my land to look like that. So what kind of trees do I want? I think because it is so dark down here, I think I'm going to put in some birch trees, just like in my happy accident a little while back. So one of the things that I do for things like that, for birch trees, etc., since I'm painting wet on wet, is I use this. I used to have these postcards, Christopia Studios postcards that a friend of mine got for me, but they have all the wrong information on the back. It's been several years. Doesn't have any of the right places and things that I used to do. So, and I put them on my camera stand, which was dumb because now I'm gonna wiggle it. So I'm gonna wiggle for a second while I take those off. What I'm gonna use is these to swipe my birch trees up into the forest. And we're gonna have a little lesson in perspective. And I'm also gonna sit out because my back hurts and I'm tired of standing up. Okay, so we're gonna stop right there. Just give you a little sped up sneak preview of the part three. Part three is going to be the longest because we're going to do all the foreground, all the birch trees and everything else, and have a little bit of a lesson in creating depth in your painting to make things look like they're closer or further away. I hope you come back and I hope you enjoy.